All right. So are we ready to move on to our presentations?
I believe so, yeah.
Excellent. And I see that they're both here. So, Ms. Johnson, were you planning to go first?
I'm very good, that's how I'd like to do.
Very good. Thank you. Locke, are you going to have her sit next to you?
Yes, please.
Come on up. Welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming.
Thank you very much for the opportunity. I do have a couple of items.
You can wait till you're seated, and then you'll be on mic.
Illustrate the points of the testimony.
She has written testimony starting on page 12, going through page 17.
Props.
Yes, props. Not quite as nice as your dome, but
Turkish food and semiconductor props. You never know what you're going to find under the dome.
So thank you again. Good afternoon, and to Senator Volk and Representative Saucier and other members of the commission. I want to thank you for the opportunity to discuss the Trans-Pacific Partnership. My name is Cynthia Johnson, and I'm representing Texas Instruments. I brought these props because part of the testimony deals with what we do as a leading semiconductor company in Portland, Maine. We take these ingots that are basically purified silicone or sand. These are cut into wafers, and then on top of the blank wafers, which we procure, thousands of devices are built on top of the wafers. These devices then are sent for further processing and become the semiconductors that you may be more familiar with. That these would sit on a PCB board in your telephone, in your that many of them are in your automobiles, your white goods, industrial goods, and so on. So just a couple of things here to show you the kind of transformation that we're able to do there in Portland, Maine. I'm going to read my statement, and I will try to go quickly, and I'd be happy to answer your questions. TI is a global semiconductor design and manufacturing company. Today, we operate in 35 countries. We serve 100,000 customers worldwide, and we offer 100,000 analog ICs and embedded processors. In 2011, TI acquired National Semiconductor in the South Portland Fab, or as we call it, NFAB. Today, TI employees at the site design and manufacture over 150 diverse analog semiconductor products. Our plant employs about 500 people. 20% of the workforce hold engineering degrees, with over 50% of those degrees coming from Maine universities. 25% of the workforce are equipment technicians, with over 30% of those employees holding a degree from Maine Community College System, and the balance about 50% of the workforce that work on the production line hold a high school diploma or above. And then we have support staff. TI supports trade agreements like TPP because they open markets for our products and promote economic growth. We also support policies and initiatives that keep us strong here in the U.S. apart from TPP, and those would include things like funding for basic research, partnering with universities in the United States, and STEM education in the lower grades in particular to make sure that we can have a strong workforce here at home. Semiconductor fabs like MFAB represent highly advanced manufacturing in the United States. The semiconductor industry as a total generated over $335 billion in revenue in 2015. U.S. semiconductor exports to the broader Asia-Pacific region represent 85% of total U.S. semiconductor exports, and of course they are the cornerstone of the global IT economy. Chips made in fabs, like the MFAB, contain billions of transistors, each functioning, interconnected, and measuring in nanometers. Semiconductors are one of the most complex pieces of machinery ever manufactured. Over time, through scaling the transistors, semiconductor fabs have been able to, improve performance, reduce power, and cost. As I mentioned before, this process begins with ingots. They're sawed into very thin wafers. TI purchases these wafers from companies that specialize in manufacturing the silicon ingots. Wafers may be sourced from the U.S. or from Japan or other countries. In order to alter the characteristics of the semiconductor, the following steps are taken: deposition, diffusion, and ion implementation. There's more on this in the testimony if you'd like to look at that. But importantly, the tools or machines on which these steps are performed may be sourced from manufacturers here in the U.S. That would be a company like Applied Materials, but also from Europe and Japan and other places. The layout and operation of these tools in the fab is a valuable trade secret. The design of the circuits and the steps for making these circuits is guided by recipes which are valuable intellectual property. So go on a little bit more on the process. In between these steps, areas of the chips are patterned with an image that for that particular layer of the device via photolithography. And that design for the mask may be done by a design team in the US, in the EU, or in India. The designs are highly valuable IP and they flow across borders. They also can be produced through collaborative team processes. After all the production steps are complete, a final layer, protective layer, is put over the entire wafer. Probe testing determines how many functional devices are on the wafer, and then individual chips are cut from the wafer, and the good dies are packaged, tested, and then shipped to the customer. InFab exports about 20 billion chips per year. The majority go as wafers, exported to Malaysia for final processing, testing, and packaging. From there, they may go directly to a customer or to a product distribution center. More than 80% of TI sales are outside the United States, and that's typical for our industry. Chips can be subject to tariff or non-tariff barriers when they are sent to our customers, which it can increase costs or bar them from markets. Similarly, the phones, white goods, or cars that are powered by semiconductors also face barriers. Finally, the global supply chain, which I've tried to touch on briefly here, on which our manufacturing rests, can be strengthened from streamlining and the predictability that TPP could bring when products cross borders. So more specifically, why does TPP matter to us? As I mentioned before, it would increase access to a large and growing markets in the Asia Pacific, which would mean further growth. U.S. exports of semiconductors to TPP countries account for 41% of total U.S. semiconductor exports. The semiconductor industry, as I've tried to touch on, is one of the most global industries in the world. The supply chain, the semiconductor supply chain and ecosystem, from raw materials to research and design to manufacturing, assembly, test, packaging, and final distribution, are spread across the globe. While U.S. companies manufacture the majority of semiconductors in the U.S., we rely on the global supply chain for raw materials, manufacturing equipment, assembly, test, and packaging. TPP countries are a very important part of this global supply chain, with Japan, Malaysia, Singapore, and Vietnam specializing in diverse segments that make up the semiconductor ecosystem. TPP provisions, such as tariff elimination on semiconductor-rich applications, simplification and harmonizations of customs and trade procedures, regulatory coherence, removal of impediments to e-commerce, and in this regard, I wanted to mention TI has an online presence now, which was put into place in the last couple of years to reach out to our customers, which are primarily designers engineering the end products that our chips go into. And requirements to eliminate tariffs on tech products strengthen the semiconductor supply chain and would better enable companies to achieve efficiencies, lower costs, and reduce risks. And some of this is illustrated in the charts that's part of the written statement. Trade secrets are a critical and important and major asset of semiconductor companies and are essential to their technological progress and competitiveness. Semiconductor companies typically spend 15 to 20% of revenue on R&D, making intellectual property protection and enforcement of utmost importance to our industry. In 2014, U.S. semiconductor companies invested $35 billion in R&D, totaling 18% of total sales, one of the highest of any industry. TPP will require the countries put laws in place to address the theft of trade secrets, which is a newer provision for trade agreements. And this would include even theft by means of cyber theft. It would also require countries to take steps to stop counterfeit products, which is a concern for our industry. As I mentioned, TPP establishes new disciplines around emerging high-tech barriers. most of which have never been covered in previous trade agreements. Another example of this would be commitments that state-owned enterprises will operate and compete fairly and not be pressured or used to create preferences for locally made products over imported products. Other specific provisions of interest to TI are furthering of the tariff reductions under the Information Technology Agreement. Many of the countries that are part of TPP are already ITA members. However, several countries, Brunei, Chile, and Mexico, have agreed to join the ITA, eliminating additional duties on semiconductors and other technology products. It also importantly has provisions against forced technology transfer, and these are laws that we find in certain countries which force companies to transfer their technology as a condition for market access. This is a growing concern for our industry and something that this agreement attempts to address. Finally, cross-border data flow and data localization is addressed in TPP. TPP ensures the free flow of data between countries, essential in today's global interconnected economy. The agreement prevents mandates that data be stored within a country, known as data localization, a trend that is on the rise in many countries. I'm getting towards the end of the remarks. Coming to my conclusion, TPP is an important agreement as it will set precedents for the future of the global trading system. If successfully ratified, the TPP will preserve and strengthen the global model of free and open markets, to the immense benefit of U.S. companies and its global partners. If TPP fails, the U.S. leadership in global trade may be weakened, as will the ability of companies to compete in international markets on a level playing field. TPP will promote open and fair trade, reaffirm America's global technology and trade leadership, and ensure that more products made in America, including technology products like semiconductors from Maine, can be shipped to customers around the world. Thank you very much for your time, and I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Okay. Thank you for being with us. Any questions? Attorney General Mills.
You just said a mouthful, and I'm delighted that you're here.
Thank you.
So we can learn more about this. And we are delighted that the company is here and doing a good business and employing so many people in highly paid jobs. So I guess I'm trying to better understand in my own little head why they've stayed here, which I'm happy about. Is it because of the workforce? Is it because of the educational compatibility, the number of engineers that are graduating from USM and UMO, going into that employment situation? And I think when we talk about the TPP, we all have concerns about losing business,
right,
if the TPP passes. You've given us the other side of the coin. Another side of the coin. But convince me, if you will, that if the TPP passes, we won't lose a business such as yours, that it wouldn't just simply migrate to Malaysia or wherever some of the materials are and some of the assembly is being done now.
Mm-hmm.
Give me some hope.
Thank you. Sure. Thank you, and thank you for the question. So a couple of things in response. And this is something that I can tell you that has the interest of the top levels of the company, including the CEO. I've had discussions with him about this agreement. So from the top of TI through the local manufacturing facilities, and we have facilities not just in Maine, but also Pennsylvania, California, Texas.
But we like the one in Maine.
Yes, Sam, we do like the one in Maine, yes. But we are here because of the workforce. We're here because of the stable. The legal system is very strong. You see this across the board for high tech companies. Many of them want to locate in the United States because we can protect our patents, protect our trade secrets, as I mentioned. But workforce also very important. We spend a lot of resources and time trying to grow a skilled workforce in the United States. We hire from universities in the United States. We also do hire from universities outside the United States, but we do try to hire from the U.S. as much as possible. Power rates, stability in that sector is important to us. Just overall cost is important. And right now, the U.S. remains a very favorable cost environment for the U.S. for U.S. companies like TI to compete in Maine. All that having been said, there are a number of things that which I tried to touch on during the testimony, that make it difficult for companies to make products in the U.S. and enter into growth markets. One of the largest growth markets in the world today for semiconductors, including outside of the Asia-Pacific area, is China. Many of the barriers that I mentioned, data localization, forced technology transfer, and so on, we see some of these policies being tried out in these countries. That puts pressure on U.S. manufacturers to either comply with those kinds of pressures or to lose the market, or hopefully to work with trade negotiators, get some of these provisions in trade agreements, have them address some of these pressures so that we can stay here, have our stable environment in which to manufacture and export. So the better we can make the conditions in the growth markets, which are primarily outside the United States, the more we are able to stay with our investments here in the U.S.
Sure. Follow up.
Thank you. If I may, two things. You mentioned the stability of the legal system. Thank you very much. We're all responsible for that. But some of us are concerned about the ISDS provisions,
yes,
of the trade agreements and how that might bring a higher level of instability to the legal systems and to competition and to the right of businesses and governments to defend existing policies. So that's a concern. Secondly, and I don't know the answer to this, but I know that there's a provision in the TPP about patent protection. And I don't know if it was limited to pharmaceuticals or all kinds of patents, where there was some kind of deal reached that you took the countries with the shortest periods of patent protections, and then you took the U.S., whatever that is now, and came to a mid-level. If I were the CEO of TI, which I'm certainly not, never going to be, I'd be concerned about that provision of the TPP that might change the patent protections for the various processes and products that you have. Is that a concern?
Great questions. The investor-state dispute settlement provisions have been of concern, I think, to a number of folks that have looked at TPP. One thing I will say about these provisions is, I believe that they incorporate some lessons learned, and a good example is an issue that you actually raised on tobacco companies using ISDS to challenge laws in Maine on tobacco products as a concern. And this version of TPP does include ISDS, but those provisions do not include tobacco companies, do not include tobacco products. Those are excluded. Now, the reason, and thanks to work of people who have looked at some of these issues and brought some of these issues forward, but the reason that these dispute settlement provisions are part of trade agreements, I think primarily, and one reason why they are attractive to companies, is that when we do have facilities like our assembly test facility in Malaysia, which is a TPP country, if we have a dispute with Malaysia over something, a treatment of our investment there, our assembly test facility, do we want to go to the courts in Malaysia, or would we like to go to an alternative dispute settlement process? And I think, as you see, even in the U.S. legal system today, there are some advantages to going to an alternative dispute settlement process. So it can be faster, it can be cheaper. You can have specialists that hear your case rather than having to go to the civil system, which can be slow, expensive, and you may have more generalists that may not understand the issue as well. So there are two sides to this. There is concerns on the U.S. and how this will affect U.S. laws. There is also, on the flip side, the fact that these provisions are available for companies that have facilities overseas to try and resolve some of these disputes. To my knowledge, I don't think any U.S. law has ever been changed as a result of these disputes. There can be monetary damages, which I think you pointed out, that can be awarded. So that's what I would say on that. On the patent issue that you raised, again, great question. And yes, there are. There's actually even some opposition in the business community to this TPP provision, which affects the term of patents for biologics. And your great memory. I think the U.S. term, or what they were seeking, was 12 years. Many of the countries which were negotiating TPP were around 4 or 5 years, and there was an attempt to try to bridge the difference. the balance, I think, that's trying to be struck there, and this is not an issue that TI, I think it's germane to the pharmaceutical industry, not something that...
Was it just biological?
I believe so. I believe that's right. Yeah, I believe that's right. But I and someone may correct me on that. This is not my particular area of expertise, but I believe that the balance that's trying to be struck there is, can companies recoup the investment costs that they put in to develop the drugs and to go through the approval process, versus access to generic drugs that can be cheaper and very effective to treat some of these diseases. So there was a balance struck there, and I think in the minds of some in the pharmaceutical industry, there's some concern about that, but not that is not one of our concerns.
Thank you.
Ms. Tree?
Thank you, and thank you very much for being here in your presentation. I wanted to follow up on some of the lines of questioning from the Attorney General and just delve into a little bit of detail. I'm interested in what this question of whether we're going to benefit more than we lose. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's the obvious question for us. And so part of that goes to the question about what were the tariffs that are being gotten rid of in your industry? You know, how much were they, and what products were they on? And then secondly, to try to understand, you mentioned Malaysia and Vietnam, for example, which are two countries that, to my understanding, have extremely low wages. And I'm interested in what the wages are of those the workers in the factories that make components or whatever it is for your product, and what in fact they do. I would be interested in that. And then a little bit about what Texas Instruments does now to address fair wages in those countries as well as good working conditions, and how the TPP would change that or not.
Okay, great. So the first question on tariffs, most of the tariff reductions on semiconductors were achieved actually in the Information Technology Agreement and a separate agreement. That goes back to 1995. However, in 2015, last year, there was an expansion, a very important expansion of the Information Technology Agreement that was also negotiated by Ambassador Froman. And includes even a larger collection of countries. It's a WTO agreement, and so countries like China were participating in that agreement. And in that agreement, tariffs on semiconductor products, including new semiconductor products that weren't covered in the original ITA, went to zero, or will go to zero. There is going to be a phase-in. There's a 3 to 5 year phase-in. Tariffs, the remaining tariffs on semiconductors. Semiconductors have fortunately been tariff-free since 1995. Semiconductors have evolved since 1995 and have become more complex. When they became more complex, they sort of evolved out of the tariff heading that was zero under the harmonized tariff system administered by the World Customs Organization. And so those were going to be subject to tariffs and had been subject to tariffs. When the new expansion came along last year, the definition was expanded and amended to include these new semiconductors. And so for the most part, direct tariffs on our goods will be going to zero at the middle of this year, or will be phased out over a 3 or 5 year time period. So we were not included. Exactly, we were not included in the TPP for that reason. It was taken care of in another trade agreement. That being said, and I'm sure you've been familiar with this, has been a number that's been mentioned many, many times, but TPP itself includes about 18,000, cuts on 18,000 tariffs, which would include some of our customers' products. So lowering the cost of our customers' products, therefore making it possible for them to sell more and us to sell more into them. So we see a secondary benefit for some of those tariff reductions, even though they're not directly on our products. You mentioned Malaysia. I want to clarify, we do not have a facility in Vietnam of any size. Malaysia is the country where we have the largest facility right now. We also have some in the Philippines and in Japan, other places. I don't have an exact figure for you on wages that we pay workers there. It's prevailing wage for that area, and I can work with the staff to provide more information on that. But in general, we obviously take the practices that we use here in the United States with regard to our workers, providing them with fair wages, advancement opportunities, professional development opportunities, and so on. We try to expand that throughout the country, the company, to our sites in other countries, and I'd be happy to provide details on that to you.
Sure.
Part of my question was how you ensure that. I say this because I just had the experience, and this may be totally unrelated to anything that your company's involved with, but I had the experience of watching a movie over the weekend that had to do with a plant in India that was a Suzuki plant, very well-established name out there, and it was just really horrible. And so part of my question was to understand better how you as a company, you know, oversee what is going on in these, you know, so you talk generally about prevailing wages, I don't know what those are, but also ensuring that the working conditions, I mean, there's, Malaysia is, you know, has been under a watch for slave trafficking and those kinds of things. So I would like to have more detail on that. And then my other question that I didn't throw into the first one, but it also related to the Attorney General's question on patents and traits and intellectual property, but I would be interested to know what changes it with the TPP in terms of your treatment of trade secrets. You know, there's two sides of the trade secret issue, and I come at this from the point of view of having done environmental protection and litigation over a number of years. And part of it is protecting your intellectual property and your business advantage, and part of it has to do with information about, for example, toxic materials that may be in some of these products that consumers and others would like to know about. So I'm interested in how the TPP addresses that, and how it changes, and if it changes in any way any of the practices or legal provisions that are out there right now governing trade secrets.
Okay, so on the trade secret question, the provision will require countries to put into place legal mechanisms to address trade secret theft. I don't know that it goes into a lot more detail about what those provisions have to be. I think they have to have a criminal element. Criminal penalties are also an option under this, and it does address trade secret theft by means of cyber theft, which is a growing problem because U.S. companies are subject to a lot of cyber hacking attacks, and those attacks result in IP being lost, trade secrets being lost, and then being used by competitors. The provision is requiring requiring countries that are signing on to TPP to put these laws into place so that companies can try and use them to address these issues if they're being found in those countries. I think the issue you're raising on the environmental side, I believe, has more to do with confidential business information, maybe, and environmental regulation disclosure that's required. I know this has come up in fracking, for example. I think some of that is separate from what we're talking about here. And the U.S. itself actually is, I believe there's a bill right now in Congress addressing trade secrets. I don't know if that has a concerns for the environmental movement, but I think it's fairly, does it? Okay. So you're familiar with that. You're familiar with it, and you may be more familiar with the details than I am.
Yeah. Okay, and the question of the part of the question I asked about
ensuring the work conditions?
The workplace conditions and what those wages are, and what you do as a company to oversee that.
Right. You know, I have not been to the facility in Malaysia, but I can tell you that what we do there is assembly tests. So let me just say that. So the process I mentioned about the wafers going to a final step in the process where these are tested and scored and packaged and then sent on to the final product distribution center to a customer. That's what's done there. These facilities are visited by our facilities and HR teams, and I mean, we have seamless operations throughout the world, so I I don't have the personal experience to tell you. I've been there and I've seen all this myself. I know that our HR folks and our facilities people have been there. They audit these facilities. I believe that the conditions are, as I said, similar to all the semiconductor or technology companies operating in that area, and I think the conditions are good. But what I would like to do is just get back with you with more details on it. I don't think it's the situation that you saw in the movie. I'm pretty sure it's not.
Senator Patrick?
Thank you, Madam Chair. Thanks for being here, because a lot of times we have entities that are probably on the negative side of trade agreements. But one of the things that I've learned in my years on the Citizens Trade Policy Commission is you've used the word harmonization. Mm-hmm. And I look at all the trade agreements from the WTO, NAFTA, CAFTA, TPP, and one of the things that came out of the papers that were leaked from the European trade agreement was that there a lot of the dialogue back and forth is looking at the harmonization of the standards of lowering them down to the lowest common denominator. And in some respects, that kind of frightens me as a non-business person. But from your standpoint, do you see benefit from actually getting our standards through the international trade agreements to the lowest common denominator, like a lot of them were looking for? Does that have value to the companies?
I guess I wouldn't characterize it as going to the lowest common denominator necessarily. I think the kind of dynamic that you're talking about is more relevant to what's going on with TTIP, where there's an attempt to see if there can be regulatory harmonization between the two countries. Two very advanced, leading economic countries. And I think that the aim there is to look at places, for example, regulations of automobiles. Are there places where the regulations can be harmonized such that companies that are manufacturing for worldwide markets can meet the one standard rather than having to meet a standard for Europe and a standard for the U.S.? So if that is the exercise and it's not a harmonization down to the lowest common denominator, it's just an attempt to see if there are places where these things overlap and can be made the same so that manufacturers can make for one standard. Yeah, I think that would be of interest to us, but it is not, I think, an exercise in trying to lower standards by means of finding the lowest common denominator, if you will. I don't.
Mr. Palmer.
Yeah, I kind of see a big elephant in the room. And the big elephant is, what is the incentive for Texas Instruments to send their product to Southeast Asia to have it further processed rather than having it processed in the United States?
Well, part of the reason is for proximity to customers. Is proximity to customers and our distribution center. Most of these devices are going for sale in Asia, ultimately, and it is part of moving the product closer to the customer before it's finally assembled and packaged and tested and put out for their use.
I'm skeptical of the reason.
Okay.
Any other questions? Senator Whittemore.
Kind of a follow-up. Is cost of labor played into that at all?
The short answer is I don't know, and this would be a question that I would have to get back to you on. I will say this is not a new development in the industry. The assembly test aspect of the industry has been in Asia Pacific, and that includes for companies like other semiconductor companies, U.S. companies you might be familiar with, like Intel and others. I want to say since the 70s, 80s, something like that. So this is not a recent phenomenon, but I would like to have an opportunity to get back to you on that, on your specific question.
Any other? Mr. Palmer.
You said that certain controls in Malaysia were auditing conditions.
Yes.
And I'm an old auditor. And I worked in Saudi Arabia for 3 years, and I worked in Indonesia for 2 years. And I'm very familiar with, back then, what local auditors were compared to American auditors. And audit has an interesting connotation depending on what your background is. And I'm kind of wondering, who's doing the auditing? Is it the Malaysians, or is it the United States auditors?
Well, my understanding is, and I again, this is an area where I would like to have the opportunity to correct the record if I'm misspeaking here. My understanding is that the auditing functions are undertaken by TI. This is one of our subsidiaries, not a contract manufacturer that we're working with. So for facilities and other functions within TI, there is an attempt to have uniform processes across the company, and that is the purpose of those types of audits, to make sure that the company is functioning in all of its locations in a uniform manner. And they would be undertaken by TIers for the most part.
Let me give you an example. Like, when I first arrived in Indonesia, we were over there. I was working for Arthur Young & Company, and I was a senior audit manager. And we were trying to determine how long it would take for Pertamina to get their financials in order, since they had single-entry bookkeeping, literally, so that Arthur Young & Company could do an audit of them. So the first thing we had a discussion with, and this was using, I had four people working with me, and this was to develop auditors for Pertamina, and they already had an auditor and a substantial staff of auditors. So the first thing we discussed was how you do an inventory. So we arranged to do an audit of a landing platform in the harbor, and you have to keep in mind how certain things work in Southeast Asia. And there's this enormous crate, and in it is a fire truck. It was actually an Oshkosh fire truck, but you couldn't see inside the crate. So one of the auditors suggested to the Indonesian auditor that they should remove some of the packaging on the crate to make sure there was a $500,000 fire engine in the crate. And the Indonesian auditor said, "Oh no, sir." He said, "Manager says fire engine in that crate, so we can't remove to look in the crate." So that's my perception of when I hear somebody talking about Malaysian auditors working for Texas Instruments.
I'm not under the
auspices of Texas Instruments, and just what, when you say auditing, I the hair comes up on the back of my neck, and that, in conjunction with the incentive for Texas Instruments to do this in Southeast Asia, this to me wraps up the whole problem with trade. And I'm a conservative.
Okay, thank you.
Was that there was no question?
It was a question, and the question was, I still don't know if it's Malaysians doing the auditing under the aegis of Texas Instrument supervisors, or whether it's U.S. people doing
the
auditing.
So, excuse me if I wasn't clear on that point. I was trying to make to use an example of the kinds of things that would ensure that we have uniform standards and good standards in our overseas facility. One of the things that I am aware of is TI personnel, not Malaysian personnel, visiting the sites, auditing the sites, making sure that they are operating in a way that is uniform and represents our values. I did not say that we use Malaysian auditors, so I just want to make sure I'm clear on that point.
Thank you. Representative Guerin.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I wondered if you saw in the potential passage of TPP any increase in jobs in the state of Maine?
Yes, I think there is the potential for an increase in jobs in the state of Maine. Maine already exports products to TPP regions, and those products support jobs in Maine. Yes, I think if are you asking generally about Maine or specifically about TI? Let me make sure I understand the question. TI. So TI will increase its workforce in response to increased demand for our products, or if we have a need for special technologists or technology expertise, we increase the workforce. So if the TPP results in increased demand, which it appears that it would, then yes, I think it would be possible for there to be increased jobs, just like it would for any industry that's enjoying increased exports.
Thank you. Oh, do you have a follow-up? Sorry.
Do you know the percentage of the TI products that are sold in the United States?
I can provide that for you after. We generally only break it down by region. I think North America is the breakdown that's used, but yes, I can provide that for you.
Of the 500 jobs in Maine, do you have, you kind of were flying through a bunch of statistics at the beginning, and I didn't realize that they weren't all written in your statement, but can you give us an average wage or it might be something that Ann would be able to provide us later. It's probably not something you have off the tip of your tongue.
I can provide it later.
Sure.
Later. I haven't run the calculation in probably a year or so, so let me give you some more.
Okay. Any other questions? We do have one other presentation. And I know that I've been down to TI and had a tour, which is obviously convenient for me where I live, but I'm sure that Anne would make herself available if any other members wanted to ever take a tour. I know Attorney General Mills, you might be very interested in some of the questions that you asked. They do a ton of, we hear a lot about how expensive our energy is here, and one of the reasons they actually like being in Maine, correct me if I'm wrong, is because cold air saves them from having to spend a ton of money on air conditioning, because these things have to be kept at a very constant temperature, and it's actually easier to heat up than to cool down. And so they make use of our cold air here in the state of Maine. And then they're also, their staff there, their engineering staff, and Senator Patrick, if you haven't been there for a tour, you would be fascinated probably, given your background. They have done so much in the way of energy conservation that they are actually inform others around the country about ways of conserving electricity and reusing things and things like air and water, and the guy there is amazing. One of my constituents who lives in Gorham, actually. So thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Thank you for your time, and thank you for your consideration on this.